Okay, so this is the second attempt at this. You might remember that you saw in my vlog that I did Inspire 2 versus Mavic 2 Pro video, and this is how that one ended.
Wow, dang.
So there was no way I was not gonna finish the review. I just didn't get to actually finish it because the Inspire 2 crashed, but we're about to redo this. It's gonna be a little windy. I'm just pre-warning you because it's windy outside, but it's a very rare time when you can get color and leaves on trees while having 5 inches of snow on the ground. So this is just the ideal circumstances. So here it is, the Inspire 2 versus the Mavic 2 Pro. Big size difference here. So I've been super impressed with the Mavic 2 Pro ever since I got it. I think it's an outstanding drone for the price, outstanding drone for the size, everything about it. Very, very good drone. And a lot of us were surprised just how good even the Mavic Air kept up in terms of actual image quality compared to the Inspire. But this one is actually gonna be extremely close in image quality. I like to point out, as I always do with all these reviews, that there's a lot of other features that make you need to or want to have the Inspire 2 versus the Mavic 2 Pro. So image quality at the end of the day is not the only thing that you buy it for. I don't say that just to justify my expense, but there are things like being able to have multiple camera operators and being able to have 4K 60 and being able to have the camera be able to rotate 360 degrees. Big factors play into why it makes it a great drone. So it's not just image quality at the end of the day. You're not simply comparing these of just which one physically has a better camera, because they both are gonna look really close. And for the sake of this review, I'm gonna shoot everything in 4K 24 frames a second. On the Inspire 2, I much prefer to shoot in 60 frames a second because it gives me some flexibility. But because this doesn't have 60 frames a second in 4K, I don't wanna have a comparison difference between those. So I'll just do it in 24 frames a second. So one humongous advantage of the Mavic 2 Pro is the actual volume of the drone. I personally am a fan of being able to fly the drone when people aren't really like paying attention to what I'm doing, because I don't like causing like a scene. The Mavic 2 is phenomenal at that. As you can hear, it's right next to me and you can barely hear the drone. Just an extremely quiet drone, which is really convenient. So this is actually the first flight since it's back from its surgery, its repair. So we're gonna hope that it was repaired correctly. One thing that's nice about the Inspire is because it has obviously feet and distance from the actual aircraft to the ground, it's nice because you don't have to worry as much about like climate stuff, like wetness and all that, because obviously the Mavic 2 and all the little drones, they can touch the ground more, so it's a little bit better for taking off. We're gonna do all manual settings here. We're gonna do F4, 24 frames a second, 100 ISO, let's change the white balance. And I'm gonna shoot in D-Log on the Mavic 2 Pro, and I'll shoot in Cine Lake on the Inspire. Color on trees and snow is just a really odd combination. So right when I get to that tree, let's go up more. One thing I've been extremely impressed with about the Mavic 2 Pro is the range. I've literally never had it disconnect, and very rarely do I ever even have it go down. It's just the connection they made on this is outstanding. The flight time as well is just really, really good. It's really useful because the more I can fly without having to bring it down each time is convenient. So like the other Mavics, you do get some high wind velocity things that come up when you're flying, but it's never been a factor in terms of it actually crashing or not having smooth like video. It still looks good. The gimbal does a great job of actually still keeping it steady. But so even though the Inspire controller is significantly more bulky than the little one, I've always liked flying this better. I just feel like it's more comfortable to hold this controller because it just fits in your hand really nicely. It doesn't feel like it's kind of a little bit of a toy. It's bulkier, obviously, but I really like it. One thing to actually keep in mind that is pretty important depending on what type of work you do, the Inspire 2 can perform really well in even very, very cold conditions because it's designed for that kind of stuff as well. So it even has warmers specifically that you put on the batteries. So if you are in a climate where you're doing a lot of commercial work with a lot of very cold temperatures, that is something to keep in mind because you may run into some issues with things like the Mavic, where the Inspire is very capable. The Inspire is not as easy to do that with. Okay, so we are back home now. This will give us a little bit of a better range test because of the fact that this is more like a real life situation that a lot of us fly in, which is that there's some houses and some different things around. So, why not do it? So we're just gonna fly, see what it does. Let's do 200 feet elevation. So because it's windy, what I'm gonna do is bring it back. It's at 3,000 feet. You can see on my remote here, we are 3 of 5 bars on the HD viewer and 4 of 5 bars on the controller, going back and forth 3 to 5. So pretty good range. So this is directly with, right in front of me is a building that, or a house that is blocking the actual direct line of sight. So pretty good, 3,000 feet, no problem whatsoever. And we're in a pretty populated city here. Lots of houses, lots of things around, and zero connection issues at all. It's just cruising right along. I'm on the way back, but having no sort of issues. I don't know what kind of voodoo magic they did with this little drone, but the fact that it has such a good range with such tiny antennas and a tiny remote control, it's unbelievable. Flying with an iPad is just so much, not even just an iPad, but a bigger screen. It's just so nice. Like, and I have the matte protector on it, so you can just see so good. The iPad Pro screen plus the matte is just like, So because the Inspire 2 has a camera that can rotate 360, the cool thing is if you're even just single pilot, I can just touch on the actual screen and rotate and it will move just the camera. So what's cool about that is if I set one of the automatic modes to just fly, where you can do like the tap to fly, or you can do just fly straight, I can change and only control the camera and let the camera do whatever I want while the drone flies straight. You can't do it with the other drones. You only can fly obviously and film what's where the drone's flying. So it's just little convenience things like that that allow you to get certain shots you wouldn't be able to get because the camera can rotate 360. Also, big thing that they added, as you see here with the Inspire 2, this is actually your front camera that is designed so that if I rotate this camera right now so that I can get whatever I want, or if the other operator was doing that, that obviously really screws up the person flying. So this is always designed for just the person flying, and this camera in the back is designed to actually the one you're filming with. But what you can do is this controller can be just for the pilot, and so I can always use this. This is always front facing, not on a gimbal, literally just designed for being able to fly. And then the other person can operate the camera. But then at the click of a button, I can just flop it and make it go straight. But it's crazy when you're looking at the first person view to see how pitched the actual drone is because of the wind. And yet it's the gimbal straight. So we're at about 2,300 feet. Little visual interference, actually, interesting. So this one's actually not as good. Okay, very interesting. So at 2,500 feet on the Inspire 2, it actually is wanting to disconnect, oddly enough. So I'm actually gonna turn it around just because I don't wanna let it return to home and not return to home. So it's kind of the first testing I've done with the comparison between them. I did a much longer range test than the one that I actually crashed in a more wide open area, but it seems that maybe in a busier area like this that the Mavic 2 Pro actually has better range because it dropped out. Now the controller was still connected to it, just the actual HD signal was much more connected, or was wanting to disconnect more. But for the sake of making sure that you guys always realize in my reviews, I'm not biased towards something. I have them both and they have uses for it, but it looks like the Mavic 2 Pro actually has a better range in just everyday environment. That's totally okay, totally okay. All right, so one thing I do wanna show, so we've done the testing side by side. I wanna put this now into 4K 60 frames a second. I do love the Inspire being able to shoot in 4K 60, even though it does it at a more narrow point of view on the camera. I really like shooting at 60 frames a second on the drone because it allows me to, when it's flying at just a nice consistent pace, especially over long landscapes and stuff, it just tends to look smoother to me, obviously. And when I'm flying at 30 miles an hour or 35 miles an hour, 60 frames a second is huge because you obviously have a lot of movement. So we won't be able to compare this. This is not as much of a comparison as much as just kind of showing what I'm talking about. Look at the pitch.
Oh my gosh. Is that because you're turning?
Yeah, because I'm turning. I'm doing a rotation plus going 30 miles an hour. But like, look at the gimbal. Like, you would never even notice it, right? So one thing that I didn't do in the testing of this, but I did in the testing of the previous review before I crashed it, was the sensors. The actual sensors on the Mavic 2 Pro for obstacle avoidance are significantly better than the Inspire 2. One of the reasons that I crashed the Inspire 2 is that the sensors didn't perform as good as the Mavic 2 Pro did. So I will cut to this clip right now showing you the actual obstacle avoidance on the Mavic 2 Pro. This was all shot before I crashed the Inspire 2. But when you watch this clip, you can see just how unbelievable it avoided trees and continued to follow me on this like ridiculous path around these trees. It did it so well that it made me forget that the Inspire 2 didn't have it that way, which is why when I did that same active track shot with the Inspire 2, it didn't avoid the obstacle as well and actually crashed into a tree. So not that active track or the sensors of obstacle avoidance in general are that important to me when I'm actually flying, because at the end of the day, if I'm in control of it like I should be, if I have line of sight like I should have, I'm gonna be in control of whether or not it actually crashes into things anyway. But if you're someone that does a lot of active track stuff or you're looking to use it for something where you're really tracking subjects and not having to worry about flying it, that can be a big, big deciding factor. The Inspire 2 was not created to be an active track type of machine. It was designed to be something that you operated, where things like the Mavic Air and the Mavic 2 Pro definitely have more capabilities and uses for things like those automatic modes that track you, because having it small, being able to just put up in the air and follow you around on a dirt bike or mountain bike, whatever it is, really, really good features. The Inspire 2, no one's really bringing with them in a backpack to track them going down a mountain. But the obstacle avoidance and the sensors on the Mavic 2 Pro are incredibly good, and they're just gonna get even better with the way that they continue to work on the software to make it work accordingly. So keep that in mind if that's something that you wanna make sure that you don't crash into things as often. The Mavic 2 Pro definitely wins there. Battery life is something I briefly touched on, but the battery life is absolutely better in the Mavic 2 Pro. You get about 31 minutes of flight time in the Mavic 2 Pro, and you only get about, I would say, 22-ish minutes on the Inspire 2, even though the batteries are way bigger. So is the aircraft, so it's harder for it to stay in the air for long. Both of them, realistically, you're probably gonna get closer to about 25 to 26 minutes on the Mavic 2 Pro because you're not always going and running it to zero. But that was a big increase for me compared to what I was used to with the Mavic Air and the Inspire, because being able to keep it up in the air for 25 solid minutes, that's a long flight. And so when you bring a couple batteries with you, it's nice being able to be in the air that long. So overall, as I expected, the Mavic 2 Pro definitely holds up extremely well when it comes to image quality. That's not something I doubted whatsoever, but like I've said so many times before, don't choose Mavic 2 Pro or Inspire 2 based on image quality. There are other factors you have to weigh. If you're interested in why the Inspire 2 might be kind of a better drone for you, depending on what you're looking for, I have a video all on that. I will link it somewhere in here if I remember to do it. That kind of goes over all the reasons why I think the Inspire 2 is worth the price. The Mavic 2 is an outstanding drone for the price point. I'm blown away by it, and I'm really excited to have it actually as part of what we do all the time, because there are a lot of times that the Inspire 2 is a little bit too big or too bulky or just not easy to carry around, that it's nice having a super portable drone that keeps quality as high as the Mavic 2 Pro does. I was really excited when they came out with that new Mavic, because I previously had the Mavic Air and the Mavic Original, and it was just, the image quality was so lacking in comparison to the Inspire 2 that now having this be so close and yet portable is just an unbelievable thing. Besides that, I could go on and on with all the different features and comparison between the two, but at the end of the day, if you really want to see all the comparisons, you can go to their website and they'll show you all the really comparisons between each thing and what does what. But that's really probably not what you want to know in this entire video. I just wanted to show you some image quality things, some range tests, and some real life use between them. I own both drones, so I have a lot of experience with them both. So if you have any specific questions, make sure you comment below. Tell me what you'd like to know. I'm happy to try to answer them for you. And as always, thanks for watching. I'm just happy that this review ended without crashing the drone.